obviously you called me and you wanted to talk to me, and I definitely want to talk to you. Maybe it's better you start, and then I may have some questions, but I take it you had some things you wanted to say?
I wanted to know, I read yesterday's article.
Yeah.
And, why did you print that, the first thing was she killed her kid, right. That was the first line of the article, and I just angry about it, because there is no she killed her kid.
Of course, the jury has found that you killed your kid. They didn't find you not guilty of murder. You're right. They found you. Their finding is that you both killed Phoenix.
See, but that's the thing, there is no they, us, or we in this about killing her, how people are saying, or how he's saying, too. And, what I said in court yesterday about people not hearing the truth, what right. really happened, that's what I mean, nobody's hearing the truth.
So what is the truth?
The truth is, I never killed her, it wasn't me, I wouldn't do something like that to my own child.
But there was evidence that...
The only evidence that there is what people are saying. My truth is that I never did it. That's the thing. Nobody's understanding, getting it, that my truth was sitting right beside me in court all this time. He knows the truth that I didn't do this.
His two sons testified and about all sorts of things they witnessed you doing to Phoenix.
You see, that's what I mean. They could say whatever they want, but that's what I mean. I don't know how to explain it, you guys weren't there to know what really happened. I know what really happened. I never killed my kid. I didn't do these things to her like everybody says I did. And Wesley knows that too, that I didn't do that.
What did you do to her?
What did I do to her?
Yeah.
I loved her. That's what I did to her. I'm not saying that I was the best parent in the world or anything. I'm not the best at explaining things, but what I know and what I have to say, it doesn't really come out the way I need to say it.
But as a mother, isn't it your duty to protect your child?
Yes, it is.
Didn't you fail in that regard?
Yeah, I failed. I failed her and I failed myself. I guess you could say you failed everyone else. That's what I mean. I'm not saying I was the best parent.
Why didn't you do anything? Why didn't you stop it?
I tried to. I tried to stop, and that's where I failed. That's what I mean. I failed.
But how did you...
A lot of people don't know, how this relationship was either. They think that me and Wes were some couple who loved each other and things were going good between us. That's not how it was between us. actually, I wouldn't even call it a relationship between us.
Well, what was it then?
That's the thing. There is actually nothing. When I think about it now, like, it was nothing between us. It wasn't a relationship. The way I see that it was more of like, like, I don't know, it just wasn't good. I didn't like it.
But you heard the evidence, and did you not have all kinds of opportunity where you could have gotten out, you could have called for help, where Wes was out of the house and you were alone, you could have called anyone, and of course you didn't. And that's, I think, one of the areas people have trouble understanding. If it was so bad, and if what he was doing to Phoenix was so bad, how could you just stay, especially when you had opportunity to leave?
Oh, I have a question. Does this recorder have to be on all the way?
Well, it's just, I guess, for my own, to make sure that, you know, if anything gets said that later on you dispute and say, oh, I never told you that or something, I think for both of us it's better that it's on, so then that way there's no misunderstanding.
Can I see, like, your notes?
Yeah, you probably can't read them very well because it's sort of sloppy, but I'm trying to take down pretty much everything you tell me. But as I see sometimes...
Can I see them just to be sure? Because I don't want to be...
You guys weren't there to know what really happened. I didn't kill my kid. I didn't do these things to her like everyone says I did. What did I do to her? I loved her. I'm not saying I'm the best parent in the world or anything. Yeah, I failed her. I failed myself. I tried to stop it. That's where I failed. A lot of people don't know how this relationship went. People think this was a relationship where everything was going good between us. I wouldn't even call it a relationship. And then I wrote down, I get angry seeing that. You were talking about what was in the paper. There is no us or we in this. The truth is I never killed her. It wasn't me. I wouldn't do something like that to my child. Nobody's getting it. The truth was sitting right beside me in court. So that's what I've got down so far.
Okay.
So I was asking you about why didn't you leave? You had opportunity to leave.
Like, in a way, I'm kind of like nervous to talk to you because, like, I don't want to, like, I don't know. I'm kind of nervous to talk to you because I kind of feel like it's like I want to talk to you.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I need people to hear the truth.
Well, and I'm certainly here to listen to anything you have to say.
Like, the recorder kind of makes me nervous, that's what.
Well, it's not taking pictures or video or anything like that. Like I said, it's just so we both know what was said, and, you know, that way nobody can accuse me of, you know, your lawyers down the road can't say I misquoted you or something, or...
Mm-hmm.
And if I have to go back and listen to anything, if I'm unsure of something, then at least there's an accurate record of what was said.
And the part in the column there that you wrote yesterday about being emotionless.
Right.
Like, can you explain, like, why you...
Well, you saw the jury, right? A lot of them were crying. You saw, I'm sure, a lot of people in the gallery were crying, the police officer, and I was watching you, and I think a lot of people were watching you, and I didn't see any tears. I just saw someone sitting there with a pretty blank look on their face. Now, I don't know what to make of that, but to me, that's emotionless.
Like I know you guys can sit there and think that I have no feelings or anything about what's going on. Like, everybody shows their emotions in different ways. Like, not everybody cries when something happens. Like, for me, like, I'm the type of person to, like, hold my tears back.
Right.
Like, yeah, like, when I'm sitting in the courtroom, yeah, I do get watery eyes, like, and I try not to let the teardrops fall because I'm the person that doesn't like to cry in front of people.
Right. But so, if ever there was going to be a time...
And I have cried in court. I have. And when I have cried, it's because I turned away and I would wipe my tears so that you guys wouldn't see, like I said. Mm-hmm.
What were you thinking? What was going through your mind as you heard Kim Edwards read the victim impact statements, as you heard and saw the jurors and...
When Kim read the statements, I felt, like, sad. I felt hurt, and, I don't know, I did have watery eyes. I just, like I said, I'm just, like, not really the type to cry in front of people. Like, I try to hold that back from people seeing.
And what about, I mean, we saw and heard all kinds of horrible evidence. We saw the video of them out at the burial site. We heard from the pathologist and the anthropologist talking about all the injuries on her body. We saw pictures of her skull. What were you feeling as you sat through all that? Because again, I think to a lot of people, you came across as really showing nothing. And some people will take that to say, oh, she must not even care, because look at her sitting there.
Well, of course I care. Of course I care about my daughter. Like people don't know me. Like, they don't know how I take things. Like, I'm like I said, I don't like to cry in front of people. Like, I hold a lot of stuff in. Like, I'm not like the type to like just freak out. Like, I can control my anger and stuff, and I just. Like, I sit there, when I sit in court, I sit there, yeah, I hurt inside, and I get angry, because, like, there's a lot of stuff that's not true. There's a lot of stuff that nobody is hearing that is right.
So are you saying that Wes did absolutely everything to her? You never laid a hand on her? Or are you admitting that you abused her?
I didn't abuse my own child. Like, there's a difference between telling your kid to, like, you know, like, go to bed or something, you know, than abusing your child. Like a little push to, like, get going, you know, kind of type of thing. That's, like, I don't really see how that could be abuse.
But that's a far cry from what the boys testified about.
See, that's what I mean. That never happened. That's a, you know, like, I don't know how to explain it. Like I said, I'm not good at explaining things.
Why would they were testifying against their own father, which would be hard enough. Like, but and they certainly told of horrible things that he did to Phoenix, but why would they make stuff up about you and not him?
See, like, that's what I don't understand. Like, there is stuff that they have said that wasn't true.
Was Phoenix made to sleep in the basement?
Was she made to sleep in the basement?
Yeah, naked on the floor.
I wouldn't say she was made to sleep in a basement.
Did she sleep in the basement?
Well, what, you tell me, what do you think? What is your...
Well...
What is your...
I mean, the evidence to me went in pretty clearly that these things happen, that Phoenix... head was shaved.
Her head wasn't shaved. Her head wasn't shaved.
It wasn't?
No, it wasn't. Phoenix had hair.
We've heard about, you know, the boys described hearing her crying through the vents at night from the basement. they described trying to give her food.
Described trying to give her food. She ate. Phoenix ate. I would feed her. Wes would feed her. She ate. She didn't starve.
Was she beaten? That evidence, that doesn't come from any witnesses. That comes from the doctors who testified about all these broken bones. Obviously, some very serious injuries happened to her. Ones that you must have known about as her mother and as someone who was with her. How would you not know your child has that kind of injury?
Like I told you, I tried to stop Wes from doing things to her.
But how did you try and stop them?
Like I tried to get her like out of his way. I would even take a beating so that she wouldn't take it. Like nobody, like I don't know how to explain it.
But wouldn't the best way to protect her have been to get her out of that house? To call the police on Wes? To take her to a hospital?
Yeah, it would have. It would have been, like, if I could change, like, all of this from happening, I would have. I would do it in a second to have this all changed.
How did you meet Wes? What's your what's the background there? Like, how did you guys meet? Where and when?
I met Wes in December 2003 through my mom.
Okay.
And
did Wes know your mom?
Yeah, Wes knows my mom.
How?
I don't know how they know each other, but they've known each other for years.
Okay.
And how we started going out was Wes kept coming to my mom's place, bugging me and always saying, "You want to go out with me? You want to go out with me?" That's what he kept saying to me all the time. And I didn't really want to go out with him because I was single and I wanted to enjoy it for a while. Right. And besides, he was way older than me. And so after he kept bugging me, I just told him, yeah. And I thought maybe, well, okay, I'll give it a couple of weeks, see how it is between us. If it doesn't work out, then I'll just, you know, leave. And like how relationships always are, they're always good in the beginning, you know.
Right. But then it went longer than a couple of weeks.
Yeah, it went longer. Well, I did about 2 months, I guess, into the relationship. I did try to leave him. I told him I didn't want to be with him anymore. But it kind of seemed like he didn't, like, really take it. Like kind of like, you know, you're not gonna leave me type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know, like, I could say that I don't like Wes. I really don't like him. And the relationship was abusive. It was abusive, controlling, possessive. Like, it was abusive, I guess you could say, mentally, physically, emotionally.
But again, there were so many chances you had. He was a truck driver. He'd be on the road for days at a time, right?
Sometimes for days.
But wouldn't that have been the chance to tell someone?
See, like, you guys don't understand, like, just when you're in an abusive relationship, it's not like, oh, okay, I can just leave then. It's not like you can just get up and walk away like that. If you've ever been in an abusive relationship, you would understand. It's not easy just to get up and walk away.
One of the points, I think, of the evidence that came out, and again, this is not from the boys, this is from police and the investigators, and that is that after Phoenix was obviously dead, and you knew that, you tried to pass off that little girl as your daughter, which obviously speaks to all kinds of guilt. Why did you do that? Wasn't that your chance to finally say, yes, she's dead, and here's what happened?
There is no why did you do that. You guys think that, like, I said, okay, well, this is what's going to happen. It was my idea to do this. It was Wes's idea to start doing shit like that when that happened that day.
You didn't have to go along with it.
Like I said, it was an abusive relationship. Controlling. I didn't want to go and pass off somebody else's kid to hide the fact that she was gone. It was his idea.
Go ahead.
I wanted to tell, about this, but he said no. He threatened. My life didn't move on when this happened. My life was not going anywhere.
And what about the concealing, the burying of the body, of course? We've heard from some witnesses that you had talked about some programs you watched and ideas you had from things you'd seen on TV about how to cover up the scent of a body, throwing pepper in the grave.
Who said I threw pepper in the grave?
Well, I don't think, not specifically that you threw pepper in the grave, but that you had talked about seeing that on TV, on some shows.
Wait, who said that?
The names escape me right now, but it was there were those couple witnesses, people that had been watching TV with you one night, and you guys got to talking about burying a body, and there was talk about how it would be done if it was done. And then I know Wes certainly said in his statement that you had talked about some things with Phoenix specifically, including that you wanted to go and cut the head off.
Oh my goodness. I don't know why anybody would believe anything that Wes says.
But wouldn't he likely say much the same about you, though, don't you think?
Don't you guys get it? Like, don't you guys understand? Like, I get so frustrated because you guys, don't understand what...
I think one of the problems here, how can you understand a case like this? It's to me, it's beyond comprehension on many, many levels.
I
can't understand what happened to Phoenix.
I could tell you one thing. Phoenix would still be here today if Wes had never bothered me. Because before Wes entered into my life and Phoenix's life, me and Phoenix were good. We laughed, we had fun, we would play, say things to each other like, I love you, hug each other. That's the life of me and Phoenix. That's how we were before Wes came into the picture.
But then, and you say, how can I not understand? But do you think there's really anyone out there that would understand then how a mother could, if what you're saying is true, that anyone could understand how a mother could just stand by and do nothing as their child is sort of slowly killed?
like, I didn't just stand there and let him do whatever, you know? Like, I tried stopping it. I would take her away from him so that he wouldn't fucking beat her. I would let him beat me so that she wouldn't have to get beaten. Like, I told you that.
But of course, you're still here and she's not.
I know, and I wish that it was the other way around. What I'm trying to say is that I love Phoenix and I care for Phoenix. And if I could have changed things, I would do it in a second so that this wouldn't have happened to her. And I'm telling you that I didn't kill my own kid. I would never do anything like that to her.
But you heard the case that it was not only acts of commission or things that you do, but acts of omission as well, and omission being things that weren't done. And of course, we can't ask the jury exactly what they found. You can't talk to them. But it's possible that they found more on you, that it was acts of omission.
Like,
that you didn't do things that you should have to protect Phoenix, that any parent should, like, should do.
Like, what do you mean? Like, so, like, saying what, that...
Well, that you're guilty by your inactions, by the fact you didn't stop this, that you didn't get your daughter help, that you didn't get her out of there.
So, what is that? Is that trying to make Wes look like he's...
Well, I'm saying they may have found that Wes did the majority of the abuse on her, but...
Well, he did do the abuse on her.
But at the same time...
And I told you I tried to stop it.
But I think...
It's not like I just stood there and said, oh, okay, Wes, go ahead, do that to her, and I'll just stand here and watch. It wasn't like that.
I think most parents would say that faced with a situation where they're watching their child's life being taken away, they would sacrifice their own life. They would do absolutely everything possible to save that child. And you can't honestly sit here and say you did everything to save Phoenix, because if you did, she'd still be alive.
Like I told you, I kind of feel like I can't even really tell you anything. Like,
tell me whatever you want.
I kind of feel like you're trying to, like, I don't know.
I'm not here to judge you. That was what the jury did. I'm here to listen to you.
Like, I don't know. I kind of feel like you're trying to switch things.
I'm certainly not painting Carl McKay or Wes McKay to be a saint in this. Not at all. He's convicted as he...
Well, of course he is no saint.
As the evidence showed that Wes, he should have been.
Wes knows I didn't kill my kid, and he knows I didn't abuse my kid. He knows that I love my kid. He knows that. And he... Through this whole thing, is what made me so angry is that he just sits there, you know, denying anything that he did to her.
But you heard his statement. He didn't completely deny it. He admitted he did some bad things to Phoenix.
That's the thing. He only admitted to some things he did to her. Like,
But then, of course, he's the one that led the police to where she was buried. In some ways, I think he was seen as being cooperative.
He's only trying to make himself look good. Like, who sits in a courtroom when you're going up on a murder charge? Like, who sits there all casual and stuff and, you know, like, this isn't even happening and, like... Like, when I was, like, when in court there, like, I would sit there too, like, well, not casual, but, like, I sit there and watch his actions and think, like, oh, you're sickening, like.
And yet, to me, I saw him taking notes a lot. He seemed to be following along with the trial. And on Friday, he was crying during some of the sentencing.
Yeah, crying only during sentencing? Like, what is that?
But look at the two statements. Look at what you said and look at what he said in his statement. He actually said he's sorry. He apologized to Phoenix. I didn't hear any of that from you. I heard you saying...
I said I was sorry.
Well, you said saying sorry wouldn't change anything.
No, in my statement, I said I was sorry. I said that in my statement, that I was sorry. And I told her that I loved her. And I didn't have to write her a letter for her to know I loved her, because I told her many times that I loved her.
Did you and Wes at all, at any point during the trial, talk to each other? I know you were in the same prisoner's box, which must have been kind of uncomfortable.
Yeah, it wasn't good sitting beside him.
Right. How come there was a sheriff's officer between you at the end there? Did something happen, or?
There was a sheriff's officer because I was really angry and really angry at him. And, because they could see the anger in me towards him.
Right.
And I guess, I felt like I wanted to attack him.
Were you close to doing that, do you think?
Yes. I was really angry that I was shaking. I've never been so angry like that in my life. I can control my anger.
Did you honestly believe the jury was going to come back and say manslaughter against you?
Honestly, I didn't know what to, I didn't really know what to, I didn't really know what to
expect,
yeah, I don't know, you could expect manslaughter, you could expect second, you could expect first, who knows?
Have you had any chance? Have you guys either, he's in here as well, right? Have your paths crossed at all? Have you talked to him either during the trial, since Friday?
No, I don't ever wish to talk to him. He has tried talking to me during the trial.
Like in the prisoner's box?
Yeah, he has tried to, and I just looked away.
Do you know what he wanted to say, or was he just calling your name?
He was talking about our kids. He was telling me how they were doing, but I didn't answer him or anything.
Rain and...
Damien. I didn't answer him. I just sat there and I didn't say nothing to him. Even though they were about my kids, I know I wish I could have said something, but I can't. I can't talk to him.
I don't know that we know much about your background. We heard quite a bit, I think, about Wes's background during that insanely long audio tape where he sort of told his whole life story to the police a few times. But what is your background? How many brothers and sisters?
I don't have any sisters. I have two brothers. My oldest brother committed suicide.
When he was how old?
He was 17.
And how old were you?
I was 12.
Okay. And how and where was that?
He committed suicide in 1993 in Swan River, Manitoba.
In the house, or?
Apparently he jumped off of a grain elevator.
Okay.
And my mom is alive, and my dad passed away in 89.
Of natural causes?
I'm not sure, I wasn't there. Apparently he fell down the stairs and choked on his own vomit, and there was nobody around to help him. I'm not sure what happened.
Right. And your mom is still alive. Do you have any contact with her?
I have contact with my mom, yeah.
she lives in Winnipeg?
Yeah.
Did she remarry or?
She was never married.
Oh, okay. Did she have any more children? Like, do you have any stepbrothers or sisters?
No.
And your other brother is still alive?
I have two brothers that are alive.
Oh, sorry. So you had three brothers?
I had three brothers, yeah.
And what about, do you have any contact with your other two brothers?
My second oldest brother, I haven't seen him or talked to him in quite a few years. I don't know. Nobody knows where he is.
Okay.
And then...
What's his name?
Martin Kematch.
Yeah.
And my third oldest brother, he lives in Winnipeg. I don't have any contact with him either.
Okay, what's his name?
Mickey Kematch.
Mickey Kematch. And are you the youngest of the four kids?
I'm the youngest, yeah.
Okay.
I'm 27.
Right.
Yeah.
And your oldest brother, what was his name?
Howard Spence.
Yeah. And your mom's name?
Bertha Kematch.
And was your dad's last name a Spence?
Yeah.
Is that why?
His name is Howard Spence, too.
Oh, okay. So he took on your dad's name.
Yeah.
So you have some contact with your mom, but no contact with your other two brothers.
No, and all my other family, I don't have any contact with them either.
Right. And so you didn't grow up in care or anything, right?
Like I grew up in care right until I was 18.
So you were taken away from your mom?
Yeah, a few times I was taken away from her. And then...
What was the problem? Was she...
I guess...
Did she drink?
Alcohol, I guess.
Was she an alcoholic?
I guess she was an alcoholic from what I...
Right.
...remember.
So did you and your brothers grow up in the same sort of foster home, or were you put all over?
Just me and my third oldest brother,
Martin.
We were...
Mickey. Or sorry, Mickey?
We were together...
And so you didn't live with your parents very much then?
No.
And what about you? Do you consider yourself having like an alcohol problem, drug problem?
No, I don't, not drugs.
Not now, obviously, being in custody, but did you at one point?
I don't think so, no.
Not alcohol or drugs?
Like, I'm not gonna say I never did drugs.
Right.
But no, I've never had a drug problem.
Never been addicted where you needed it to get you through
the day?
No. And drugs like cocaine and
no.
Okay. And what was growing up in care like?
It was horrible. Because I like the last person I lived with was my evil auntie.
Mm-hmm.
I call her evil because she was abusive physically sometimes and mentally and emotionally. Mentally and emotionally.
Is that your mom's sister or your dad's
No,
sister?
She was my auntie through marriage.
Oh, okay.
And my uncle.
And that was your last placement, like in your later teens?
Yeah.
And then where'd you go after 18, on your own?
Yeah.
How far did you get in school?
I went up to grade 10, but I finished my grade 9.
Mm-hmm. Finished grade 9, then went up to grade 10. But you never finished grade 10?
No.
Okay. Have you ever had any kind of regular employment, or?
Yeah.
Where's that? What kind of work?
Well, my last job was Club Region Hotel.
Okay. What were you doing there?
I worked in housekeeping.
Okay. And how, like, when was that compared to when all this happened with Phoenix? Were you working there around that time?
That was 03, the year of 03.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, barring an appeal that gets you a new trial or somehow gets the sentence overturned, you now face the prospect of a very long time in prison.
Yeah.
What's that going to be like?
I don't like 25 years to life. That just like, I don't know. It's like not, it hasn't like really sunk in yet to like it. I don't really feel it that it's happening yet.
Right.
Like, I don't know. I don't know. I guess I feel mixed emotions about it. I can't really say I feel one way.
I take it none of those emotions, though, are happiness.
No.
What's been your experience in custody like? Because we've often heard these kinds of crimes, inmates get treated very poorly by other inmates.
I don't know. I just...
Have you had problems with people saying things or doing things to you because of what you did? Or what you were accused of doing?
Like, I could care less what people call me or say to me because, you know, like, I know I didn't do this. So that's why it doesn't bother me what they say to me. I just don't pay attention to what they say.
But you do admit there's a lot more you could have done.
Like I said, yeah, like I failed. Like I said, I wasn't the best parent, but I know I didn't do this.
And after all you've heard about what Phoenix went through, what do you have to say about her experience?
About her experience?
And what she went through in life and what happened to her.
What I say is that she never deserved any of this to happen to her. She deserved better. She deserved the life that we were living before he came into the picture.
The one other thing, I know they want this room right away, so I'll be really quick, but the one other thing I wanted to ask you about, there was 3 months before this happened, when CFS came to your door investigating some kind of tip, and you answered the door and didn't let them in to see Phoenix. Why was that?
3 months before this?
Yeah, in March of 2005. Remember when they came, the worker testified about coming there, and then you wouldn't let them in, and then they closed the file after that. They never did see Phoenix, but they saw rain, and you were at the door and you told them that they couldn't come in. Why was that?
Why was that?
Yeah.
Like, why couldn't they come in?
Why didn't you let them see Phoenix?
They
wanted to check up on her and you didn't let them, and then they closed the file. Which I don't understand why they did that.
I don't like CFS. I don't like CFS.
Right. But they were there in Phoenix's interests.
I don't remember. I don't think. I'll have to.
Yeah, that was in. It came out during the trial in March of 05. Somebody called to say something about Phoenix, so they went to check on her at your place on McGee, and the worker testified that she came to the door, you answered the door, they saw rain, and rain was fine, but they were there to see Phoenix, and you said that they couldn't come in, and so they left, and then they closed the file, and they never came back again. And a lot has been asked about why it happened that way. Why? What if they would have seen her that day? Could this have all have been avoided? Would they have seen injuries on her?
I'll have to recheck on that, like what was said, because.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, I can't answer that right now, so I'll have to see what was.
Okay. Is there anything else before we go that you wanted to say?
I don't know how you're gonna print this up. Like, you know, you have your own doings, whatever. But, like, I hope you don't like try to say that. I hope you don't try to say that I was emotionless or something. Mm-hmm.
You've explained to me. And you've now heard, obviously, that Phoenix, her remains, will get a burial. What do you think about that? It's been a long time.
Like, I wanted her to get a burial a long time ago. Long ago.
Right.
And I felt too that she wouldn't be able to rest until this was over. Mm-hmm. And I feel like better that this case is done so that she can rest.
Right. Are you going to appeal though?
I think that's something that my lawyer has to answer. So I can't tell you yes or no.
If your lawyer asked you today though, do you want to appeal? Would you say yes, or are you content to just take the sentence and move on?
Oh no, like. If my lawyer asked me if I wanted to appeal, of course I'm going to appeal, because it's not right.